Thank y'all for joining me. I'm traveling. So I'm somewhere between Greensboro, North Carolina, and Raleigh-Durham. But I didn't want to miss class. And thank you, Representative, for standing up and for me. These next few nights, as I shared last night, we're going to be focused on how to be prepared for this new year. Can y'all see me? Okay, we're going to be focused on how to get ready for this new year. And so what I'd like to do is, last night we talked very briefly about First Peter and the instructions that First Peter gave to the church of Ephesus in regards to how to live in victory. And his black closing words were, cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. And so that was our message. As we go into this new year, let us be very diligent in casting our cares upon the Lord, that we give him everything, all things, in all situations, with the knowledge that as we give these things to him, he in fact cares for us. Now, tonight, we're going to look at Paul, because what Paul did differently was Paul gave us what I would call a step-by-step method of applying what Peter said in regards to casting your cares upon the Lord. So if you would join me tonight in the book of Philippians chapter 4, I think it'll be clear on how we implement these things. I know that generally what Peter said makes sense. Give it to the Lord and know that he cares. And that's confidence. But what Paul did in Philippians 4, we studied this early in the year. What Paul did, and the Lord kind of opened up a little bit further for me today, is give us some instructions in the why. Like, the why do we do this? And how does it benefit us to do this? And how does this method prepare us for trusting in the Lord? As Reverend Kenshi was saying when I came on, this year came out of nowhere. This time last year, if you had said that we spent three-fourths of the year in a pandemic, three-fourths of the year not in church physically, three-fourths of the year in quarantine, social distancing, wearing masks, wearing gloves, having to buy extra Lysol, nobody would believe it. But that's how trouble comes. And it's incumbent upon the Christian not to focus on these things, but to focus on God. Because looking at trouble doesn't help you in the trouble, but looking at God helps you in all situations, including the trouble. So if you go ahead and join me in the book of Philippians chapter 4, we know that this is Paul's letter to the church of Philippi. We also are aware that Paul was writing this letter while he was in a Roman jail. And we also know, and I'm going to come back to that in a minute, we also know that Paul wrote this letter and utilized the words rejoice and joy more than any of his other letters, and quite frankly, more than any other book in the Bible. Because Paul did not allow his situation, circumstances, dictate how he felt or what he did or how he was behaving. His focus was completely on God. I can imagine it. From that day that God struck Paul blind on the Damascus Road, when Paul got his eyes back, that was the most important thing. What he got was a heart for God. He focused on God truly the rest of his life, and we can see it in his writings that God used him. But in this chapter 4, he begins by encouraging those believers in Philippi to prepare to close to them. He encourages them in his closing comments to kind of work together. If you see the early verses of chapter 4, one of the first things he said was try to resolve a dispute between those who were there in Philippi. There was a dispute that was going on. And Paul said, hey, let's not stick there. Let's work together. And that was what he said in chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. And 3, he encouraged those who were around watching the dispute between these ladies in church to help solve it, because he reminded them that each of them were in the same position as regards to being in the Lamb's Book of Life, in the name of the Book of Life. But they were all saved, so it was the right thing to do. It wasn't even extra. It was the right thing to do to work together. But beginning in chapter 4, in chapter 4, verse 4, we see the beginning of this, what I would call the most encouraging and the most instructive part of the Scripture of God. I'm going to read 4 and 5 and talk about it briefly, but 6 is where I want to hang our hat. Because 4 through 6 are necessary. It's like an equation. But 6 has an impact beyond our minds, because it impacts our very souls and our posture. First thing the Christian ought to do, and this is looking forward to the new year, is that we have to take a deliberate position of rejoicing in the Lord always. Paul reiterates by saying, again, I say rejoice. Paul is saying that our rejoicing is not at all related to the situations around us, but our rejoicing is in the fact that we have a relationship with the Lord. I think I've said this before, but no matter what our situation, if you are saved, if you are a child of God, if you believe that Jesus is your Savior, if you have eternity in your view because of the promises of God, your obedience to the promises of God, there is always a reason to rejoice. If you are well, rejoice. If you are sick, rejoice. If you have a lot, rejoice. If you have nothing, rejoice. Paul explains it later in this chapter. But what he wants us to do is just rejoice in the fact that the Lord is ours and we are his. That's the first thing. Too many of us, we allow external to dictate how we feel and how we think, as opposed to letting the reality of the relationship with God lift us above what we endure. Verse 5, he says, let your moderation be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. In this text, in this verse, he's letting us know that it's important for the rejoicing on the inside to manifest itself in the outside. What does that mean? That as we are in Christ, as we are rejoicing in the Lord, as we are happy about our relationship with him, it should reveal itself or manifest itself by people looking at us and realizing that we're never too up or never too down. We're never too happy, never too sad. But that again, this is the main thing about moderation. That there's no external stimuli that causes us act a certain way. But in fact, it is the internal operations of having a relationship with God in which we rejoice that causes us to be strong. The word moderation oftentimes is used as it relates to, you know, drinking or some drug that would change how we behave. Paul is saying, don't let external stuff change how you behave, but let what's inside of you in that relationship that is solidified in Christ such that we rejoice in it. Let that be what people see. If you're a Christian, people should see you mad all the time. They should see you upset all the time. They should see you sad all the time. They should see that you are being undergirded and over inhaled and moved by the relationship that you have with God through Jesus Christ. Now, verse 6 is where I want to spend a little time tonight. In verse 6, Paul says this. Be careful for nothing. Don't worry about nothing. Don't be anxious about anything. Now, I've read this a thousand times. I know I've preached it probably anywhere from, I don't know, 15 to 20 times in the time I've been Pastor St. Peter. But what I do know for a fact is that each time I've read it, each time I've preached it, it becomes a little more meaningful to me. I would say that the beauty of having a relation with God, the beauty of the Holy Spirit that comes through our relationship, that we have as a result of our relationship, and the power of God's Word, every time we read it, if we're open to God speaking to us, we'll hear and learn something different. So in this verse, let me share what the Lord shared with me. Don't worry about anything. Now, let me be clear. He's not saying, and God is not saying, I don't care about that. He is saying, don't allow the anxieties and the things that we endure ourselves individually or that's taking place in the world, it's even happening to our family members and friends. Do not allow those situations to cause us to focus more on that than focus on God. Like we talked about last night, there's a certain amount of selfishness in focusing on even ourselves or somebody else we love so much that we forget that God is sovereign. That we forget that God is omnipotent. We forget that God is omnipresent. We forget that God has authority and power of everything. He's saying do not allow. In other words, if you got a bill due, you can pay the bill, or call and make an arrangement. He's not saying don't care about it. He's just saying, but also don't allow it to take the best of you. Don't allow your circumstance to pin you down. Don't allow your situation to have you all tied up and not such that you can't call on the Lord, that you can't call on God. You can't seek him who is able, but also seek him who cares. He says, so being careful for nothing means do not allow the worry that you could have or that you do have to overwhelm you to the point that you forget about talking to him who can have those worries. But Paul didn't stop there, because if Paul had just stopped there, it would have been encouraging. It would have been a kind word. It would have been a nice word. It would have been inspirational. But Paul moves on, and this is what I finally see. Moves on and gives us a theory. A theory. No, not even a theory. It's a prescription. This is how you implement the first part of verse 6. Be careful for nothing. Don't be anxious about everything. Don't allow your worries to confound you and defeat you and destroy you. Paul says, in order for you that to happen, Paul says, you must follow these steps. Look at these steps. But in everything, by prayer. Paul, first of all, gives us the posture of not worrying. I think this is fascinating. the more God has revealed to me. How many of us can honestly say, and how much did you say, that when we get in the position of prayer, that we almost always feel better before we get a word out because we know that we're submitting and coming to talk to him that can hear our prayers, to him that does hear our prayers, to him that does answer our prayers. I always find it fascinating when I was in college, and I think my son, my oldest son, shared it with me this week. When I was in college, and whenever I had some issue, I would always call home. If I just ran out of money, I'd call home. If I was ready to come home, I'd call home. If I, you know, if I found myself in any jam, quite frankly, even a social situation, I'd call home. And it was just like mama, daddy getting on the phone would make me feel better because I would know I was talking to somebody who probably had an answer or who could rectify my situation. Now, as much as mama, daddy could do, they did, but here's the reality, they couldn't do everything. But what Paul is telling us is that we can talk to him who can have the answer. And so he's saying, as he says, don't worry about, don't let anxiety get the best of you. His next commentary is, but instead take the posture of prayer. Let, every now and then, I got to say this is pastoral. And I shouldn't say every now and then, on a regular basis, each of us as Christians should find ourselves in a prayer position. Now, it could be on your face, it could be on your knees, or it could just be sitting in your car in a quiet place or wherever you are. You should find yourself regularly in that place. Two reasons. First of all, if you know that getting in that position will, in and of itself, getting ready to talk to God will alleviate some of your frustrations. That's a benefit. But more importantly, constantly being in a prayer position strengthens our relationship with God. And in doing so, it opens the door for our capacity to do what the Bible says next, what Paul says us next. So in other words, if you just go through the week and you don't pray none and you don't pause and talk to God some, then what you do is set yourself up for a shortage of communion. But if you're constantly in prayer, what you're doing is fortifying your relationship with God, and in doing so, it strengthens us in a physical sense. So when Paul says, but in everything by prayer, he's saying the first thing is to take the posture of prayer. And really what he's saying is make prayer a priority, but even beyond that, what he's saying is make prayer something you look forward to and make time for prayer. I've come to find out, as I've gotten older, that if you don't make time or set aside time for prayer, you might never pray because you have always to find something else to do. But if you have a posture of prayer, that means you're always looking for your next opportunity to pray, then you'll find yourself more apt to pray. Put like this. How many of us think about what we're going to eat for breakfast somewhere between the time we get in bed and the time we wake up? You already think about what you're going to eat. But how many of us, you know, around about 10 o'clock after you break, you wonder what you start thinking about what you're going to do for lunch. You might be at work, you might be at home. And how many of us begin to think about what we're going to eat for dinner about 2 o'clock? It's not that we're hungry. It's just a part of our physical makeup. Paul is saying a part of our spiritual makeup to be the same way, planning to pray, looking forward to prayer, anticipating the opportunity to pray. That's what he's saying when he says in prayer, that's the position that the Christian should have 100% of the time in our lives. If we're looking for the position of prayer, and in doing so, it increases our expectation about what's going to take in that prayer moment. I got to make y'all laugh. So Thanksgiving, I cooked a lot of food. I was glad to cook again. So my friend and I, we fried some turkeys, and I say we. I just sat and watched it, but he did do a good job. I made a prime rib. I made some macaroni and cheese. I cooked a lot of little dishes. And I will admit that I was looking forward to cooking those on that day. Christmas, I was looking forward to a brunch. So I looked forward to purchasing the items and preparing the items for brunch. The day I found myself as I was riding in the car looking and trying to figure out what I was going to prepare for New Year. So my point is, as I look toward those things, I'm excited. I'm looking forward to the pieces, the buying this and the purchasing that and getting this pan ready. I'm already thinking about it because I'm excited about it. That's the same way, my brothers and sisters, we should have as it relates to prayer. We should be looking forward to our prayer time. We should be excited about our prayer time. We should be full of the Spirit of God, just looking forward to get that time to talk with God. And so that's what Paul is talking about when he says, by putting everything by prayer. Now, Paul didn't stop there. He would have helped. Paul didn't stop there. Paul continues and says, but in everything by prayer and supplication. Prayer, when he refers to that, is the posture and the deliberateness of it. But supplication is in regard to the intensity of the prayer. If I'm a talk turkey. Sometimes, myself included, we allow prayer to be a routine. We allow prayer to be something we go to get out of the way to say we pray. But Paul is saying that our prayers should have much more intensity than a routine. It's not, prayer is not stretching your legs so you can, you know, walk with a smoother gait. Prayer is not brushing your teeth so you have fresh breath. Prayer is not getting your hair right. Prayer affects us in a whole nother level. And so Paul says, let your prayer have intensity. Let it be in such that when you take the posture of prayer, that your prayer begins, or at least your consideration. Sometimes we meditate. Sometimes we just talk to God. But whatever it is, let it be an intensity to that prayer. This word, supplication, is best to me described by the prayer method that Hannah had in the book of 1 Samuel, in which she, in her coming to the temple, in her interaction with the priest there, she came in such a way, meets the priest, she came in such a way that he was thinking she was strong. He came in such a way that she noticed her. And I'm sure more people that come to pray that day because they was celebrating, you know, one of the feasts. But he prayed so that the temple, the Eli, noticed her. He didn't know. He couldn't even explain it. Maybe he had lost his intention to prayer. But whatever the case was, he tried to call out. Said, well, look, you must be drinking. And she was like, no, there was some intensity in her heart. And she supplicated before the Lord. She poured out what she was concerned about, and she was ready to take in whatever God said. That's what she did. Remember, supplication opens the door for us to get rid of what we're worried about so that God can fill us with what we can have faith about. Supplication is intensity. And let our prayers not be routine, brothers and sisters, as we go into this new year. Let us our prayers not just be ritual, but let them be something that in and of themselves, as we talk to God, we experience him in that moment of prayer. Prayer ought not be something that you do, and again, that you just say you did, but prayer ought to be something that you're so excited about that you start talking to God and you get lost in prayer. My prayers that I have prayed in my most intense times, in the intense prayers, I know y'all felt this before, you're transformed to where you are to where the Lord wants you to be. You can already see and feel the presence of God, and you already know everything is going to be all right. Not the same feelings you have when you get on your knees to pray, but the feeling that comes with God having spoken to you. I think Shirley Caesar put it best when she was saying that song, in that song that Sister Mary Fox sings out called Jesus. You know, when you about to get on your knees, you already know God worked it out. When you just like because your intensity is such that before your knees can hit the ground, you already feel the power, the presence, and the response of God. That's what supplication means. And Paul is saying that's the step to not worrying about nothing. Because when you start supplicating for the Lord, all of a sudden you're convinced, not by your intellect, but you're convinced by the presence and the response of God that God has it under control. And so when you get off your knees, you get off your face, when you stop praying, then you are able to say, I ain't gonna worry about it because God has it. I love this right here, and I got to share this story. I had to share it in a while, so I don't feel bad about it today. When I was in my sickness, I would call on the Lord, and somehow or another, when I would get off my knees by the power of God, it was if I already had the blessing that God has promised. You know, I was on a Facebook post of a friend group with transplant, people who had transplant, who waited on transplant, and one of the things that I always saw was a certain amount of anxiety that comes with weight. But, and I will say that by the time I came around to the fall of 19, I was convinced that God had it worked out. Now, I will say this. I didn't know how he was going to work it out, but I knew he was going to work it out because I had been supplicating and putting and calling out and crying out to God so many times and giving over to him that I was determined that I was going to live the life that he gave me however many days it was, and in doing so, that I wasn't going to worry about what was going on. Yeah, I might have something to worry about, but I wasn't going to worry about it because I was supplicating and giving over to God. But this next part is even it's as important because Paul says you got a couple things together. You got to tie your supplication in with your praise. Somebody ought to say amen about that. I feel that you ought to tie your supplication in with your thanksgiving. Why are you asking God for whatever you're asking him for? Thank him for what he's already given you, and particularly in regards to what you're praying for. If you're asking God for provision of your financial needs, thank God for what he gives you in terms of where you are. Like, he just said, Lord, I need a little bit more money to make it. But say, well, Lord, thank you that you allowed me to make it for what you've given me. And again, I got to say this testimony, but I'll be praying and asking God to deliver me from my sickness, give me a new heart. I was aware, and I had to thank, Lord, thank you, Lord, that you have kept me right where I am so long. Thank you, Lord, that you hadn't left me. Thank you, Lord, I can still get up and have use of my arms and legs and breathe and preach and do whatever you want me to do. So thanksgiving and supplication go together. Don't just give God a reason. Don't just supplicate. Supplicate while you're saying, Lord, I thank you for what I got. Thank you for what you give me. Thank you for what you're doing. Even as I ask you to do X, Y, and Z, thank you for A, B, and C that you've already done. As we go into this new year, add that to your prayer equation. Supplicate. Pour it out to God. But then also thank God for what he has done. And this is the last part. Let your request be made known unto God. So supplication is intensity. Thanksgiving is the listening of it. And thank praise to God for what he's done. But Paul is here saying that God wants to hear our prayer requests. You may be hesitant to share your prayer requests with your friends. You may be hesitant to share your prayer requests with your family, friends, and church, even the pastor. You may be hesitant to share with coworkers. But guess what? Don't ever be hesitant to share what you are requesting of God. In the book of Ezekiel 37, God said this. He said, listen, Ezekiel, tell them that I want to hear their plea, and I'll grant their plea. God says, I know what they need, but I want to hear them ask me. Not that God wants us to beg. That's not at all. But God knows that in that spiritual connection that comes with asking God for something and telling him and being very specific, that even in that, even in the request, our faith grows. But certainly when God gives the answer, our faith increases dramatically. And so God said, I want you to call out to me. Just like we talked about last night, God wants us to cast our cares by him. God wants us to be specific in our prayer request. And let me say, brothers, because sometimes we don't do specific. We just say, Lord, help me. Lord, deliver me. Lord, strengthen me. Lord, heal me. But it's okay. Matter of fact, it's encouraged. God promotes us being very specific in our prayers. Because, again, in that, God does great things. Last story for tonight. But I was, one day I came to church and I felt awful. And I was sick and I began to pray and praise things worse than praise the Lord. And the Lord told me to pray and ask him, but also to thank him for what he had done. And I thanked him for every individual problem I had. And I asked God to give me deliverance from each of those individual problems. Shortness of breath, individual walk, retention of fluid, whatever it was, my heart, ejection fraction. I asked God very specifically those things. And what I found out was I began to trust God more in those moments because I had given it over to him specifically. It wasn't just my intensity. It was my specificity, I believe, that gave me the strength of the knowledge, that God had it under control. So what I want to tell you all tonight as I get ready to close is as we go into this new year, let's upgrade our prayer lives. How about that? If you got a cell phone, every now and then you got to upgrade it. Whether you get a new one or upgrade the software, you upgrade it. And it's voluntary because you want more capacity. You want more features. In our spiritual lives, let us upgrade by changing and transforming our worries into prayer, our prayers into supplication, our supplication into thanksgiving, and our thanksgiving into request, so that we may grow in the Lord, that we may have more access to him, not because he's moved, but because we trust him more, that we may have more capacity to do what he says because we're so connected with him through our prayer lives. I'm going to stop tonight. I'm almost in Durham, North Carolina, so keep me in your prayers tonight. But I just want to say thank you for being on tonight, and I thank God for this word, and I pray that these words we have heard these two nights and the others that God has for us will give us the strength to enter through this new year, not with our head held down and not with worry or frustration in our minds, but instead with the full knowledge of the great power of God who will deliver us, who will bless us, and who will keep us. God bless you. Let us pray tonight, and I'm going to add a couple of special prayer requests tonight. There's a good friend of mine who is waiting on a heart, Randy Thornton. I want y'all to join me in praying for him. There's a good friend of mine, Sister Catherine, who has got COVID, but we're praying for her as well. If y'all join me, and what we're going to do going forward is we're going to make it. I can't tell you how we're going to do it. I'm going to talk to the Minister class to figure out how we're going to do it. But we're going to, I know we're praying in the morning, but I like to do special prayer requests in the evening as well. The Lord has placed that upon my heart. And so we're going to be a 2 times a day praying church. But I know that I I love you, and I'm praying for each other. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we say thank you for the great grace and the great mercy that you have made available to us through Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. God, I pray that as we go into this new year, that you elevate us, that you would strengthen us, upgrade our walk. We may have this capacity to not worry, but to cast our cares upon you, to not worry, but to pray, to supplicate, to thank you, and to make our requests known to you. And God, I pray as we do that, Lord, that you would just let us live triumphantly and victoriously in this new year. Let us not look to see what might happen, but let us look to you to heal from which cometh our help, knowing our help comes from you. God, I pray that you bless every household that's represented, bless every family that's represented, and please, God, bless every individual that's on this phone line or this Zoom line tonight. And I pray, God, again, the word will get in our heart, our feet, our ears, our mind, and Lord, show enough, let it get on our lips, our tongue, our vocal cords, and our lungs, so we can shout it, declare it, and promote it only to say it to the dying world, to each other, and to ourselves. We love you, and we thank you, and I pray again a special prayer for Brother Randy Thornton. In his weakness, God, make him strong by your power. God, draw him closer. I pray, God, that the healing of Captain and her family and strengthen them. In Jesus' name, we love and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Hold on, Zoomer. God bless you, phone line. Hold on, Zoomer. I'm going to shout y'all out tonight. Hold on.
Amen.
Amen.